fam, today I had on Elina Danilova, a force to be reckoned within the world of holistic wellness and personal empowerment. Elina's journey from her roots in Kazakhstan to her current base in Los Angeles is a testament to her resilience and passion for uplifting others. With over 2 million followers across social, she's a multifaceted entrepreneur, wellness coach, and dance enthusiast. Elina brings a unique blend of expertise and creativity to her work. From her pioneering efforts in clean beauty with Elina Spray Tan to her impactful coaching sessions aimed at helping individuals break free from limiting mindsets, Elina is dedicated to guiding people toward a life fulfilled with purpose and with joy. Guys, if you like the show, please share with a homie or on social media, and definitely subscribe. It truly means the world to me, and you're helping to be a part of this consciousness revolution that we're experiencing. Enjoy the show. Elina, welcome to the show.
Thanks. Thanks for having me.
Yeah. You know, people that don't know what's going on behind the scenes, we are just really hot up in here. We were like sweating because there was a little air conditioning situation going on. And
hopefully it's under control now.
Hopefully it's under control. So if you see us sweating a little bit, though, that's what's going on.
Yeah.
We're not like nervous or anything. It's just hot.
Just hot.
Elina, well, this is funny because I like to ask my guests on the first question is, what was your last oh shit moment? And that could be like anything good or bad, but it kind of feels like it just happened. But if you want to go beyond that, when is your last oh shit moment? What comes
this
to mind?
This is a good oh shit moment just happened. I have so many of them. I don't know. Maybe I could share. Just recently, I got a message from my Instagram followers, and they wrote a message saying, "Hey, Elina, you're so inspiring. I love all of your dancing and all of your videos. It just makes me happy, brings me joy, and just... I feel the joy and warmth through the screen, especially knowing that I can't walk anymore and I'm on a wheelchair. And thanks to the technologies, I still get to experience the freedom of flow through you and the joy."
Wow.
Yeah. That was like, I was so overwhelmed. I was so overwhelmed with emotions of gratitude and humbleness. And I was just like,
that's so powerful.
It was a powerful message from that person just to remind me, hey, like, there's so much power in positivity and anything you do. So ripple effect, you affect anyone. You don't know who's going to watch you. You don't know how your message, your words going to impact others. And I was just, inspired to continue to do what I do.
That's amazing. That's beautiful. Yeah. Congrats. That's so cool.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, you don't know who's going to watch you, right?
Sure.
You don't know. You have a very big following, though. So I feel like sometimes it could be easier people that don't have big followings think that if you have a really big following, that it's much more easier to feel inspired to create because you feel like you have this big audience. Do you believe that that should go the same for people with even smaller audiences because you just don't know who's actually
exactly
watching, right?
Yeah, it's not about the following. It can be two people following you and you impact someone really deeply. So
yeah,
just always look for inspiration, and there are always ups and downs. I don't have inspiration 100%. I have my downs. I don't feel creative, or I feel kind of low. There are moments like that, but it's okay. You're a human being. But don't focus on the big crowd. Focus on impacting that one person that's following you.
Yeah. I love that. So going back a little bit, you're originally from Kazakhstan.
Yes.
And most people think that Kazakhstan is like they think of Borat when they think of Kazakhstan, which is super ignorant. And I realize that that's ignorant, but that's just what kind of most people have an image of. And I know that even those images of that and that movie are actually incorrect. There's like a whole thing with that not actually even being Kazakhstan, and people are very offended. So let's clarify. Why don't we just share with the audience, like, what is Kazakhstan like and how did you end up in LA?
Kazakhstan, beautiful country. I've never actually seen Borat until I moved to America.
Oh, is that right?
And everyone's like, oh, you're from Kazakhstan, bringing up all of the quotes. I'll never forget the image when they brought me. I was in college and my friends brought me to this movie room and they said, we're going to watch Borat because you've never seen it.
Uh-huh.
But instead of all of us watching, it was me watching the movie and them watching my reaction to all the things that was happening on the screen.
It's like this YouTube reaction videos.
But no, it's a beautiful country, very nice. So. Also, people get confused a lot that thinking that I'm Kazakh. I have no Kazakh blood in me, but I just I was born there with my parents. So it's nice. It's very different. A lot of Asian culture, diverse culture. Okay. I was born into a Muslim country too, because Kazakhstan is a Muslim country. So it's just interesting experiences.
And yeah. And how'd you end up in LA?
LA, yeah, just how do people end up in LA randomly, actually? Through just a relationship that I had in the past. The relationship didn't work out, but I liked LA and I was like, it's hitting my vibe. I love the people and I felt comfortable to be here.
I love that.
Here I am.
Well, that's great. Here we are. How long have you been in LA?
5 years now.
5 years. Okay. Gotcha. So going back a little bit into the sort of the positive mindset, you know, you work as a wellness coach. It's one of the many things that you do. But as someone who preaches a lot of positive mindset, right? And as that follower of yours said that you sort of do bleed this positivity through the screen, and it's a beautiful thing, you really do. So I gotta wanna acknowledge that. Now, there's tons of people that that truly have all of the excuses to be sad, to be upset, to be angry. How do you approach positivity and a positive mindset with people that actually have the excuses? Like, I have real excuses to not, you know.
For sure. I mean, I find excuses every day. Mm. But it's almost like training your muscle. When you work out at the gym, if you consistently show up and do little by little, increase your weight to a higher number, you'll gain muscle. And if you continuously do it, you'll maintain it. So same thing with positivity. It's kind of like a mindset choice. You wake up and instead of following maybe that negative self-talk or self-doubt talk, and basing all of the excuses on your current maybe valid condition, but trying to reframe and your brain into thinking positive or finding the benefit of even the negative stuff that's happening to you right now and looking for the best option. Like, what is it bringing to me? Is it to challenge me? Is it to help me grow? And kind of transforming your brain and mindset to that thinking.
Yeah. Do you feel like there's a little bit of, would you say a little bit of fake it till you make it at a certain standpoint? Because if someone's just coming in from just like negativity of accumulation of years of negativity and just things happening to them, mm-hmm. we can say some of these beautiful things, but it's just not going to hit. You know what I mean?
Yes. Definitely, I believe in fake it till you make it at some point.
Okay.
You have to trick your mindset or your brain a little. There's an even scientific approach about smiling. Hold the smile
a
little, you'll feel already different.
Right.
So, but of course, it's not just one of those things and bases. You need help. You need support. You need counseling, you need coaching, you need someone, you need a proper environment as well for that. So you can just pull it, fake it till you make it and be happy, and hopefully everything is going to go away, because you need to put an effort to that and also create that environment that will support you for this.
Yeah. So when you're saying environment, what aspects?
Environment, everything. You know, when they say whatever you listen to, what you eat is what you become. Mm-hmm. So being really selective with how much news you're listening to, or what you're surrounding and what your people are. Maybe people sometimes add on to the negativity. If they're constantly looking for the bad, or they start the day and say, I had the worst day, hear it out.
Yeah.
And it's already a start. So it's what do you also listen to books, for example? What do you read? continuous learning and finding that inspiration of someone that went through the similar thing. And yeah, eating also affects it. It's just like a wholesome, holistic approach how you can do it, because everything is interconnected, the physical, the mental, the emotional state being. So,
yeah. And I think we live in a world too now that people that could be surrounded by negativity in their physical world, maybe it's their friends, family, or whatever, they can still make that choice of being like, well, I'm still going to listen to these podcasts or these mentors. You can have basically some of the best mentors in the world that back then you couldn't. You can now have it literally on your phone.
Everywhere.
Right?
Yes. Yeah. And just even tune into your podcast and
get inspired
by the guest speakers that you
can.
And spreading the awareness. And, you know, even like you're talking about conscious leaderships and things like that. But it's a personal choice.
Yeah.
We're also surrounded by social media. And I'm just noticing on Instagram and Facebook, how explicit of the news that they show and graphics that they show. So just being mindful who you follow and who you listen to, because it's so constant. It's everywhere. TV, social media platforms, they can destroy you or they can bring you up. So you have to be really careful with that too.
Absolutely. Yeah, there's like a little bit of a tough sort of balance trying to find it in, right?
Because
I, for example, probably to a fault, I would say and admit that I listen and watch very, very little news because I want to avoid that as much as possible to sometimes where I realize like, I'm like, okay, I should consume a little bit, you know, but it's a tough balance because then it's like the algorithm starts to really take over, right? So you're not really choosing what you're consuming and then you're just kind of
keep pushing and pushing.
Yeah. Yeah. And like, and I feel like even myself as someone who tries to be very much, I have a very much a growth mindset and I'm trying to be very conscious about my actions and all that. I mean, I see myself just opening and picking up and opening like Instagram or whatever, just unconsciously so many times a day. Yeah. It's like, sometimes I think of myself like, okay, I'm only going to open, like I constantly move the app and where it is on my phone.
I've done this before.
Yeah. So then I can now have to swipe a few times and then decide like, why am I opening this right now? Mm-hmm. You know, like, is there an actual intention behind me opening it or am I just doing it out of like an anxiety type thing, you know?
Interesting, so, yeah. Even trying like when they came out with the idea of pausing and using the social media and having like a pause day, I've noticed the same thing. Like you automatically go to the app, but then it's paused. You can't really see because you took the time off. It's like this amazing, I'm blanking the actual word, but giving you a break from Instagram without actually disconnecting.
Interesting.
Social account. So you can set up a timer where it pops up and says it's time for you to relax and
be
off of Instagram. And there were, I've tried it a few times and even myself, I've noticed how it's such an automatic thing. You're like, oop.
Totally.
And then you can't see it and you notice, oh.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's not good.
100%. It's so much, yeah.
Yeah.
So, Elina, mental health has become very mainstream. Mm-hmm. At least in terms of talking about it. It's May, which is Mental Health Awareness Month, which is awesome. So now we have so much more awareness than we did before. However, I feel that we as a society are still suffering. Sometimes I wonder, it feels like we're suffering more than ever before. And so I'm wondering, is there really more suffering happening? Or is it just that the awareness now is greater? And it always existed. And maybe people before just didn't talk about it as much. Or we're actually just suffering a lot more because of social media and constant comparison and so much that's going on. Where do you think that sort of stands?
I think it's perhaps even both because there is a lot more happening. Plus, within the past a few years even, we went through such a shift. It impacted every single family and person in the world. And so it brought up a lot of things that weren't addressed before, a lot of emotions that people didn't know existed, trauma, et cetera. And I'm very happy that it's becoming like the thing to talk about it, but it's also giving that option for people to be a little bit more open and feel okay to share. So whether this turbulence that happened, it wasn't good, but it also had, I feel like, a good energetic shift for this. So people can now focus and see, okay, we know how it used to be. What can we do to make a difference?
Absolutely. Yeah. At least for me, what I've noticed now too is just with men a lot more. Like I think, you know, women have always felt much more comfortable talking about emotions always. And so now I'm starting to see it with men my age, which most at this point they're already married or have kids or whatever. And just hearing them talk about it with other guys around my age when, you know, sort of talking about their mental health, I love it. It makes me really happy to hear other men talking
about
stuff.
Empowering.
Totally.
I mean, I've worked in the medical field for a while, and my last position I worked with mental health people, and there was a big percentage of guys, but they were so intimidated to talk about or open up, but they were very suppressed. They felt really low emotionally, and it's just like the stigma as well. You don't show that side of you. It's always you're a bigger person if you don't show your weakness, which should be the opposite. So
totally
seeing them come up front and being vulnerable, and that's how they gain the strength too.
Yeah, I mean, it's just generations of unlearning, though,
for sure,
because it's generations of also of war and fight, you know what I mean? There's so many things that we consume and watch of our fathers and grandfathers of just you know.
It's just that one small step towards a big...
Exactly.
For sure.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely.
I grew up in Kazakhstan, been in Russia, and people say it kind of look down on people that go for a counseling session or some sort of...
It's still that way.
Of course. It's a sign of weakness in some sort. Whether you're a woman or men, exactly, or if a man cries, it's not a good thing for the public. So just seeing that, being raised in that and coming here, like exploring that alternative option of being open and being vulnerable, raw, and experiencing all of the emotions.
Yeah, I love that. Yeah, clearly I have to remind myself that I am in a bubble in a sense because of the content that I do consume and a lot of the people that I hang out with and surround myself with, where I'm starting to see that being a thing where it's much more normal to talk about it. So I'm seeing so many more men talk about it and like being okay with crying and showing emotions, all those things. But it's still like just scratching the surface, like you said. The majority of the world, the majority of just about everywhere, and that's not it.
Still hoping to progress to the better.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
But we have that opportunity to speak about it and make it more comfortable for others to open up as well.
Absolutely. Yeah. What's up, guys? I hope you're enjoying the show. If you love the show, please share it with a homie. It would mean the world to me. Also want to let you know that you can check out sebastiannam.com for more resources like this, and also www.goglobal.agency, a digital marketing agency that's end-to-end helping purpose-driven and mission-driven brands scale their impact. Again, that's goglobal.agency or sebastiannam.com. Please hit me up straight up on Instagram, DM me, ask me questions. I'd love to connect with you and see what you thought about this episode or other episodes and what you want to hear more of. Much love. Yeah, absolutely. You are constantly dancing.
Constantly
dancing. And you have a huge smile that bleeds through the screen as that person was sort of sharing that with you. What does dance do for you?
Movement is life. So when I started, dancing was just fun. When you dance, you forget about all of the stressors. You need that movement in your body to release particular energy stagnant. We work with it all the time. And it just brings life to you. When you listen to music and you're dancing, you're automatically happy. And dancing is also just like life. You learn so many lessons through this, being open, flexible, and being put on the spot of learning the steps. And also, it's just a beautiful dance of life that you get.
Yeah. So you said being put on the spot to learning the steps.
Steps.
So that's something that, you know, even for me, that's always been like, ooh, like that's embarrassing for me, right? Because maybe it's just not the easiest thing for me, right? Or something like that, right? So should everybody be dancing?
Everyone should do something, and they shouldn't be stopping themselves from feeling embarrassed. A lot of people say, well, you're a great dancer. Have fun. I love watching you dance. I won't dance. I have two left feet. I'm like, yes. Maybe some people are not naturally inclined to dance, but it's just a beautiful thing to try and try something new. At least don't be scared and don't be harsh to yourself. It's not about the perfection and looking great and knowing the steps. It's about enjoying it fully with your heart. Whether you're dancing in the shower, singing in the shower, dancing at home and exploring your creative side, creative voice through that. It's just an opening channel for you to feel the emotions. And
totally. You don't have to be dancing on your stories or on social media or posting it on Reel. You could just be dancing by yourself in the morning, and that's still, you know, adding to your life.
Exactly.
Yeah. Yeah. I want to read a quote by Hafez.
Okay.
Every child has known God, not the God of names, not the God of don'ts, not the God who ever does anything weird, but the God who knows only four words and keeps repeating them, saying, come dance with me, come dance. Yeah. Have you heard of that quote before?
No, I haven't actually. Beautiful quote.
Yeah. What is it? Something come up for you on that? Just in terms of God and sort of the connection sort of with the divine and how that could be connected through dance or through spirituality.
For sure. I mean, when you dance, you connect with yourself, with the emotions, with you, like I mentioned before, even expressing yourself. If you've never danced, you don't know who you are in that way, right?
Mm-hmm.
Your movements, everyone has a unique way of how they portray themselves through the dance and movements. And that's the beauty of it, exploring and owning it and shining through that. on the dance floor or not in the dance floor, but in your own way.
Yeah. Yeah, I love that. It reminds me, the first time I did an ecstatic dance was in Thailand, in Bali. Mm-hmm. It was in Bali. It was about like 8 years ago or something like that. And if for whoever's listening doesn't know what ecstatic dance is, essentially, it's sort of this organized dance where there is a DJ or someone playing the music, but it's, first of all, it's sober, so nobody's supposed to be drinking or consuming anything that's mind-altering. And it's also not meant to be where anyone's kind of like hitting on anybody. It's meant to be like very much for yourself. So yeah, it's very much personal. And it's supposed to be about fully expressing yourself without any sort of judgment or anything or anyone else type thing, right? So that's kind of the idea of an ecstatic dance. And for me, the very first time, it was so hard for me to try to really let go. And I did by the end of it, but it just taught me, just showed me how like ingrained it is for me to be constantly thinking about what others think about me.
Exactly.
You know?
It's just like, what will people think about me? How? And you kind of limit your expression in that. I've tried a few of those dances as well here on Venice Beach.
Yeah, yeah. And again, it's the like, Sunday one.
You know, I've been in public with so many different people, and you would think as a dancer, I'm easy to dance. But again, it's a different type of feel and expressing yourself. But once you let go, like you said, completely relax and allow yourself to be and to explore and dance and have fun. Not only you bring yourself joy, but you discover something about you, the new feelings, the new exciting moments.
I love that. Yeah, it really is pretty awesome. So you talked a little bit about sort of, you touched on somatic movement, right? Mm-hmm. So somatic yoga, somatic movement, and you talk about that in some of the content that you do, and releasing emotions that are stuck in the body. How does that happen? Why do emotions get stuck in the body, and how does dance or movement help?
Sure. It's just if we suppress emotions, our anger or aggravation or something, we need some sort of outlet, right? If you laugh, you're not going to keep it inside. You're going to give it an outlet for this. Same thing with other emotions. It's okay to feel any different range of emotions, but you don't want to suppress it. Or else it physically affects you, affects your emotional state and mental state. And I practice this at home, the somatic dance or the movements as well. I think it's an amazing way to release it and just not keep the anchor somewhere or not feel expansion, but you know, when you feel anger, you usually feel contraction in a particular area where it holds it. So you want to release that instead of holding it in your body through movement, bounce it off, shake it off, jump it off.
Do you have a specific exercise that you would want to like suggest to somebody that's trying to work with this of being like, oh, yeah, I'm angry. Like, I don't know where it is in my body. It's everywhere. Like, how do I go about finding out where in my body the anger lies?
Sometimes you can just tune in, like if you close your eyes and start thinking about like what makes you angry, feel it in the body maybe somewhere, and just put an intention and clear it with your thought and put positivity through that. Or if you're doing by movement, just shake it off, shake off the bad energy, jump a lot. If you're angry, stomping usually helps to just get rid of this anger or box it up.
Or like punch a pillow stuff.
Yeah, go to the room full of clothes and scream and shout it out to release it.
Love that. What about other forms of art? I know you have painting workshops, right?
Yes, I do.
How does painting work with in terms of, it's essentially a creative outlet, but how do you feel that painting really helps with stress and emotions?
Well, you know, I think we're so built to follow particular directions and also so scared to let go and try new things in the unknown. We follow the guidelines, we like structure in some way, but painting is art. You explore your soul. So I kind of say that painting is the project of your soul, of whatever is inside you and kind of depicts you. So when you bypass all of the stress, limitation, feeling uncomfortable to paint, then you use the colors and you feel the emotions. It's very therapeutic, just relaxing. It's maybe silly and to some people, unless you're an artist or those that don't practice it often. But once you dive into it, just you get lost in the world, and because you allow the visions to be portrayed in the painting.
Yeah. How do you, so do you feel that it has to do specifically with the colors?
Colors, textures, and okay. the way I lead the intuitive painting workshops. Yeah. I just provide just basic tools of painting, paint brushes, mm-hmm. texture, and letting people explore. They can paint with their hands if they want and whatever comes to their mind. But the idea is to actually do it, to make a first step and start the process.
Yeah.
Because if you're thinking and overthinking, you start getting more stressed instead
yeah.
of being relaxed of what am I going to paint, etc. But art itself or drawing itself is just a really calming exercise, very therapeutic. So like as horses, yeah, if you notice, some people do horse back riding and they find peace in that as well, grounding.
Yeah, the grounding with animals is huge. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I took a pottery class and I wanted to make sure that it wasn't just one class. So I signed up for like a month-long type workshop where I was going in multiple times a week. And oh man, I loved it so much. Mm-hmm. It was just, there's so much grounding going on in terms of just using your hands. And also the whole spin wheel thing with pottery is like mesmerizing.
Yeah. You know? Being able to control something and sculpt something.
Uh-huh.
Yes. Even going back to the intuitive painting, some of my clients that I work with, they will start the process. And as they draw, they realize how they are in life.
Mm.
They're a little bit rigid. They notice it through lines that they unintentionally draw. And it's almost like a self-revelation because they work with this painting and they go through emotions of uncomfortable blocks, self-doubt, fun, adventurous things. But it's interesting how it comes up. And you'll even see it in the structure of a painting. Some of it is very rigid. And they'll say, my understanding from this becomes that I'm a little rigid in my life because even the way I draw, it's all structurized, there's no flow. And through painting, I've realized maybe I should be more receptive to and open to things that go on. So
that's really cool.
Mm-hmm. Things happen.
Yeah. So when you're doing this, are you looking for some of these things with clients? Or are you,
sure, yeah.
So after they're done going through the beginnings of the drawings, like you kind of come in and analyze it together?
Yeah. So I'll share a little bit of the process.
Yeah.
It's kind of unique. I'll start with a small meditation and I'll go over the guidelines. Not the rules, because there are no rules to create, just to let them relax and ease into it. It's guided by music, the whole process.
Yeah.
I may do a little bit navigation or, you know, talks during it, but I allow the space to be quiet for a person to connect with the painting. And at the end, we talk about their experience, what they felt, how they felt, what realizations they came through, some of the things, if I need to guide them, let's say like if I'm noticing something in the picture, particular colors or the feel that I feel, I'll share with them and I'll encourage them to open up of why exactly they chose this. So, and it's not guided as using specific colors where, you know, red is associated with anger, for example.
Right.
They use colors based on what they feel. So maybe a little bit different from the normal systematic or normal thing that we know about the colors, but...
Right. It goes a little bit beyond sort of our general...
Exactly. And just talking through with them of how they feel. Sometimes if they feel even a block to start the painting, that's where I jump in and ask them navigating questions to help them set themselves a little bit relaxed and set themselves back without overthinking the process. Yeah.
Nice.
It's a beautiful journey. It always comes up differently and range of emotions come out, crying, laughing.
Interesting.
Yeah.
That's super cool. I say that I am a recovering perfectionist.
Okay.
And so when it comes to painting or forms of art, the toughest thing for me is just kind of detaching from the result, period. And I can't remember if this is an actual study or, but I've read it a couple different times and I've heard it a couple different times where there's basically this professor and it's an art class and it kind of separates it into two. And at the end of the semester or the quarter or whatever, there's going to be essentially like an award or a ranking of like the best pieces of art that were created by the groups. And one group is supposed to spend the entire time creating just one perfect piece of art, while the other group is supposed to create one piece of art every single day, no matter what. And so basically by the end of the semester, you've got this one supposed quote unquote perfect piece of art by the one group. And then you have another group that's created just hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of pieces of art. And always the best, most beautiful, amazing art comes from the ones that created art every single day without caring. Because first of all, there was no attachment to the process and the result. And secondly, just by the mere act of creating over and over and over and over again, you're learning and getting better and better, right? So you actually are sort of perfecting that art while sitting here and trying to perfect something, you know? Yeah, exactly. Have you heard that one before?
No, but I can definitely see it.
Yeah.
Sure. And in my personal life or even with the intuitive workshops that I've been doing with people, seeing that. But again, that's just shows how much it stops us if we're following that particular perfection.
Totally.
It just limits us to steps. And if we go a little bit beyond and let go of that perfectionism a little bit, we're going to discover more.
Totally.
Read so much more.
Yeah. I mean, admittedly, I started this podcast now. It's been 4 years now. But truthfully, I wanted to get it moving well before that. I knew that I wanted to do it. But there were so many things that were stopping me from getting it going, you know? I think to a certain extent, I'm happy that there was a certain amount of planning and strategy behind it. And I did want to create something that was beautiful and it was well done, because I do like things to be well done. And there was other reasons too. But at some point, you got to start. You know what I mean?
Exactly. I just posted a reel about this, talking about the first step is going to be the most challenging, but it's the most crucial in your journey. Even just relating to my social media and creating videos, there are so many times I've stopped myself previously. What's not perfect? I didn't say something right. I have an accent. People won't get it. People laugh. And there's just like talk.
Yeah.
And what it led me to is a week passed by, no posting. Another week, no posting.
Yeah.
It's just yourself self-conscious of that perfect delivery, which will never happen until you actually start doing things. And it applies to everything in life, whether you're painting, whether you're posting videos.
Totally.
But once you make that step and just continuously do it with an intention to make it beautiful, of course.
Yeah.
You'll learn so many things and you'll implement from one after another.
Absolutely. Steps. Yeah. I mean, so you have a very large following and you post a lot of content.
I do.
So is that, is that something that you kind of got to a certain point by simply doing what you're saying, just to like not be a perfectionist, be like, you know what? I'm just going to post a ton of content. There's the intention's going to be there and it's going to get better and better.
Yep. Yeah. I just got to the point where I had to stop myself and figure out what's my intention. Why am I posting? Is it just to look pretty, perfect and posh?
Mm-hmm.
Or is there a particular message that I want to deliver? So if you look at my videos, a lot of them are raw. A lot of them were not properly edited, for example. And just because before I had to push content, so I wouldn't even stop myself because I feel like there's a message that I can deliver to people or something that will help inspire others to move forward and gain strength. And why should I stop myself with the perfectionism rather than just pushing in? So it was actually very challenging for me in the beginning too.
Really?
Yes. I'm a very private person in general.
And opening
up a page for me was...
When did you start posting?
2 years ago.
That's it?
Yeah, that's it.
No way.
Yeah.
Did you already have a following?
No. So before I had like 1,300 friends. I was private. And someone pushed me and they said, you know, you should kind of share your journey, share you a little bit with the rest of the world.
Yeah.
And after I pressed that button and became public, I had a little bit of anxiety.
Yeah, of course.
Because I thought so many people will see, it's going to be just there. Social media. But I think, you know, when you're moving in some proper or right direction, things just unfold even more. So I gained traction and all of this went into now my big following and my exposure.
Just 2 years ago?
2 years ago.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow. Like, this is so interesting. Like, I love this. Like, people should hear this. Like, you literally, you had 1,300 followers 2 years. You have 2 million now.
Yeah.
Was there one specific turning point that caused something to go viral?
For sure. It was my dancing video that went viral.
Okay. And, it was one specific dancing video?
Yes.
Okay.
And then just went up. Then I started posting more.
But the consistency, though. Your consistency is what...
Consistency.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of people look at me and say, oh, it's easy for you, Elina, because you have big following.
Totally. But it wasn't there.
You have a beautiful life. I'm like, no. Because I have my ups and downs. And
yeah.
It looks fun and exciting. Sure. You have big following. But again, it's not about like the luck. Yeah, maybe I got lucky with that one and just threw me into the pool of other influencers or to the public. But it's all about the consistency, dedication. And just
totally.
Whenever it's low, when you have 10,000 people unfollowing you and then 20 following you back, seeing all of these trends, you're still going and still moving.
Now I assume you have to just ignore that stuff, right?
Of course.
Yeah.
And it's just like a life journey.
Almost. Yeah.
Experiencing.
Well, you've heard that definition of luck, right? When readiness meets opportunity.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
Yeah. So sure, luck, but that's readiness meeting opportunity, right?
Agreed.
Exactly. Yeah. That's so cool. So yeah, thanks for sharing that.
For sure.
Yeah. I love that. I know you said you had, you worked in the medical field, right?
Yes, I did.
And you shifted from sort of the medical field into entrepreneurship. We could talk a little bit about your spray tanning business that you have, which is in the clean beauty space. Mm-hmm. But first, what inspired you to make that shift? Why did you leave the medical field? What exactly were you doing in the medical field?
Medical field, I was just a patient coordinator. My journey started just to be a part-time at front desk. And I've worked for almost a decade with doctor's offices, emergency rooms, managing business kind of things. And because I graduated with business and communications.
So okay.
But I just got to see the depths of the hospital situation, the politics of it.
It's bad, huh? Yeah.
And just like the circle that the government creates, and don't really want to get into this politics. I don't know.
Uh-huh.
Like,
you can say whatever you'd like. I mean, we all know this is one of the most screwed up healthcare systems in the world.
Sure.
Let's be real.
Like, just being like working in American system and seeing how there's prescriptions, they're pushing so many prescriptions expensive, and they push all of the bad foods for you to consume so you can take prescriptions because you have diabetes or a bunch of other things. And then they change the prescriptions into something else and say, forget about that medicine. Now this one works and it's going to be a lot more for you. And they consume, and then you take medication, and you have to take medication from that medication.
It's freaking wild, man.
It's crazy. And I got to just see the journey of it. Definitely was blessed because I always questioned, why am I still there? What's my purpose? And when I defined that, I got to see the backside of it. And it inspired me to wanted to make an impact and make a difference a little bit more to empower people so they can take control over their lives rather than just trusting the doctor in another examination, but actually make a difference in their own life and do something from the well-being and the health point of taking care of their physical body and being aware of like what other tips and tricks that they can do on a daily basis to feel good while they're still exploring the options with seeing a psychiatrist or a doctor.
So that's what it was. It was mostly sort of seeing these ugly truths type thing that felt unaligned. I just said, I gotta get out of this.
I just got to see the after effect of this, and then I felt, but I also felt like there was something more for me waiting than I wanted to, and I thought it was a great time right before or after COVID a little bit. Stepped out and wanted to step into the wellness and health optimization and explore that option.
Love that. Yeah, it's always mind-blowing to me when I go to like I have Kaiser as health insurance. So you go to a Kaiser and you go to like the cafeteria or the food and you're literally seeing like, and it's not just Kaiser, most hospitals have all of the foods that are making people are sick.
Yeah.
Those are the foods that they're feeding people in hospitals.
Yeah.
What in the world? I think that I hope that you know, maybe like 100 years from now or when we're all dead, right? And like people will kind of look back at these generations and be like, I can't believe that's what was going on back then, yeah. Right? And it's like...
Eventually.
I think it has to be that way.
Of course. Yeah, it's just an interesting cycle of life that they create. But I was grateful for those years that I've had, the experience, and brought me from my la-la land probably into the reality to see what goes on. I was able to be a part of people's healing journey or just journey when they're the most vulnerable. But it also opened up my eyes to what I want to do and how, what, like, just to be actually a good human being and pass on a good message, then there are ways that you can live a better life.
I love that. Well, you're a wellness coach. You inspire a lot through dance and paint and things like that. You also have a spray tanning business.
Yes.
Which is a mobile spray tan business, correct?
Mobile, but
right.
I also have a studio.
Oh, okay, great, awesome. And it is, from what I was learning about it, it's very much about clean ingredients and things like that. Now, beauty is one of the dirtiest industries out there.
Yes.
So clean beauty is definitely on the rise. Mm-hmm. So tell us a little bit about that business.
For sure. I opened up my spray tan business very close to before I left my 9-to-5 job. And initially, when I wanted to start something, I thought it would be a great entrance for me as an entrepreneur. But I'm very particular with smells, with products that I use. You just have to be aware of like what you put on your body.
Yeah.
Guys, I'm sure they use a lot of different products, but girls a lot more cosmetics and perfume. And
literally all over your body, and your skin is your biggest organ.
And my intention for this spray tent was to, what could I do that would be less harmful?
Yeah.
But we'll have good ingredients and will be beneficial. We'll empower people, make them feel confident, pretty, feel great. And so I just started looking from their different products that they offer, tried so many things on me just to see what I like, what I don't like, ingredients and eliminating it. I have to tell you, there's a lot more solutions with bad stuff and so many colorings than it is to just find a clean product.
Yeah.
And it's important for me just carrying the, in this organic, if you can say, product. But I just want to know that whatever I apply to other people, it's not going to damage them as much as, for example, even laying out in the sun.
Yeah. Are there solutions for that? Right now, I noticed you saying as much. It's tough for it to be super clean, basically all the way clean.
Exactly. The spray tan, just the main ingredient is the chemical, the DHA chemical that pigments your skin. So you kind of have to, it's a man-made product.
Okay.
But additional ingredients, they can be much cleaner. So you can't really call it organic or super clean just because of that man-made chemical.
Got it.
But it's the main chemical that exists in all of the tanning solutions. However, the ones that I chose, they're just, vegan, cruelty-free, non-toxic for your body. And I have clients that are also mommies-to-be. So for me, it's very important to know what I'm putting on their body.
Yeah. Why do tans empower us?
Tans empower just one shade. I don't know. It just does something. I mean, we talked about it earlier a little bit.
Before we started recording. Yeah.
But even myself, I'm very pale. and it's just like the visual effect of it. You look so different.
I wonder what it is.
The color, the visual, maybe.
Yeah.
So that's my guess, but it feels better. And I feel like you're so used to seeing yourself from one perspective, and then a little bit of shade makes you feel happy.
Totally.
Changes the trajectory.
I love that. But I love that you focused on, all of the clean aspects of it. And I just really love your journey and, how it all came to be. Touching back a bit as we're closing out here on, authenticity. You do speak about the importance of authenticity, vulnerability, staying true to yourself. Mm-hmm. And how in this world of, sort of going back to the social media thing, right? So in this world of, likes and views and algorithms and stuff like that, how do you feel that you can really do that without worrying about what is going to be trending or what is going to help you grow? How can you really stay true to that?
Well, that's challenging. I've had moments where I would track my likes and then I would catch myself like, oh, wow, I'm being distracted.
Yeah.
Or just aiming for to be famous or to have viral views. That's not the goal. So it just comes to the core.
So you admittedly were doing that, clearly.
My goal wasn't to catch the views, but I always watched like, oh, who liked me? Oh, I got so many likes.
Got it.
And I caught myself in the moment where I felt like the likes were validation for me.
Mm-hmm.
That was like a very different kind of dark journey to follow.
Yeah.
So I had to remind myself and pull back because what I'm producing is not for viral views or not for likes of what I'm creating. And I'm happy to hear that it's noticed that I'm speaking with authentic or like leading with authenticity because that's what I want to be.
Yeah.
As authentic, as real as possible. There's so much of, you know, just a blank. There's just so much of inauthentic people. And it's just like being true to yourself and being true to showing your true self to others is really important. Don't get distracted with algorithms or all of that.
Yeah. What is that intention for you? Do you have the same intention every time you're beginning to create for you? Is there like this sort of North Star that's always the same and then you create different things around that? Or is it change every time you're creating?
I have a solid form that I follow
where
I want to know if I can educate people and deliver something that would be useful that people can apply to themselves.
Okay, so there's always that intention first of educating, so giving value of some sort.
Yeah, giving value I think is important. I get value from you. You taught me something amazing and we share all different gifts.
Yeah,
I think that's really important. And just sharing my journey, it's, you know, I don't really specifically just focus on beauty on my Instagram or social platforms. I focus on my life and I show the difference, different things that I do, and but try to be as real as possible.
Yeah. So. Yeah, for sure. Do you worry about how certain content may or may not tie to your businesses, for example, or sort of letting go of that even brings more business to sort of like mission-driven businesses that you have? Because you have your coaching, your wellness coaching, and then you have your, you know, clean beauty brand.
Right.
And so both have beautiful purposes behind them.
For sure.
Do you think about that when you're creating content? Because I think a lot of us, people are listening to this podcast maybe, or people that are creating content, they are worried at some point, like, well, how is this going to help, like, my business or not? Like, the bottom line, right?
Well, I can see the question popping up on this. It's just business is me. And, you know, it's not just some business. Of course, combining it together brings more clientele. But it's interrelated because it's me. It's my desires, how I want to portray a good cleaning and good clean products and, you know, like empower people from the same aspects and empower them to aim for dreams as well as you open the business. So my message relates to both and they're kind of just combined together.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah. Well, Elina, what do you feel are the top two character traits that a conscious leader must embody today?
I believe a conscious leader needs to embody empathy and positivity. You have to be empathetic. You have to allow people to be heard and show that compassion because everyone is on a journey. Everyone has a different journey. And as a leader, you just want to be there for a person to challenge them to grow so they can get on a different level as well and understand their journey but help them get even better for their head. And positivity is everything. It's everything. It touches so many hearts and leading with positivity instead of looking on negative and just knowing how you handle yourself and teaching others and contributing even in a future generation to spread that positivity will make a difference in so many aspects of our lives and the company structure and in the relationships that we create with people, with friends, with family.
It all starts with us. That's beautiful. Yeah. Well, you're truly a conscious leader, so keep doing you. And now what we'll do is I want to, you know, we'll cut out here, but like, you're going to have to maybe teach me like a little move of some sort, sure. Because this is definitely out of my comfort zone.
Okay.
And so after all that we've been talking about and all of the content that I've seen of you, if we don't do a little like step, like I would feel ashamed, you know, like it's not complete. Yeah, for sure. So what should we do though? What little step are you going to teach me or show me?
I feel like we can do bachata.
Bachata? Okay, we'll do bachata.
And come back into your roots. I think that would be really good.
Well, my real roots would be tango.
Tango.
Do you do dance tango?
Yes, I do. But
oh, you do?
We will need a little bit of space.
That's a little bit more hardcore, yeah. More space.
But
okay.
I think bachata will just we do can... a little Latin.
Okay, dances. Perfect. Perfect.
So move some hips. And
nice. Okay, cool.
After sitting in chairs for a while.
Right on. All right, so we'll cut to that. We'll set up and we'll do a little something.
Cool.
Awesome.
Cool.
I hope you enjoyed that episode. If you like the show, please subscribe or share with a homie. It means the world to me. And honestly, straight up, just hit me up. The easiest way on Instagram, SEBNAUM. Ask me questions. I want to be here as a resource and a source of inspiration. I hope you have a beautiful rest of the day. Much love.